Hello, everybody. Today I am going to be reviewing Blue Velvet. This film came out in 1986 and it was written and directed by David Lynch. I talk about David Lynch a lot on this channel because I am kind of obsessed with him, but I'm going to try to spare you a lot of the incessant flattery, but I just have to say, the big reason why I admire him is because of how he is able to sort of deconstruct film and story archetypes and really explore what lurks underneath all of that. Film is an illusion, and illusions come from dreams, and he really likes to explore all of that using a lot of kind of avant-garde elements of surrealism, a lot of kind of distorted, very disturbing imagery, and all of that sort of bleeds into a lot of the pulp entertainment that he's creating that we are so used to viewing without even considering why we're watching it. By the time Blue Velvet came out, Lynch had already established himself as one of the most interesting Hollywood directors working in movies, and, you know, he had made films like Eraserhead, which is, of course, a kind of a surrealist work, and it was his first film. And then he makes a film like The Elephant Man, which was very widely critically acclaimed and so different, much more straightforward. Blue Velvet, for me, is one of his greatest works, and it kind of combines those two ideas. It is a very straightforward film, but it also has a lot of that distortion that I mentioned as well. And he uses all of that to sort of tap into the unconscious mind and really look at that through the filter of this sort of tawdry detective story, one that is very entertaining and one that is very palpable to the mainstream. And of course, there is another great director out there who did a lot of similar things in his day, and that would be Alfred Hitchcock. Now, I would say that Blue Velvet and Rear Window, they definitely remind me a lot of each other. And that's, David Lynch did mention that Rear Window is one of his all-time favorite films, and it totally makes sense because both of those films have just kind of like an ordinary person at the center, the protagonist who is kind of thrown into this detective story. And both films are very entertaining, and they have the three-act structure, so everything is very easy to digest. But they also explore a lot of the darkness within humanity, a lot of the things, the desires and the hatred and all of that that we are ashamed to talk about, but that we need to recognize within ourselves. And Blue Velvet is able to do this in so many different ways, with all kinds of very different shifts of tone. I mean, it is very satirical, really funny movie, and it's also horrific. Lots of horror elements in there. It's a detective story, and of course it has a lot of surrealism as well. I shouldn't say a lot. I should say touches of surrealism throughout. And the opening sequence of the film is maybe one of the most famous opening sequences of a Lynch film, and I think of all the opening scenes or opening sequences he ever did, this one is the most Lynchian for sure. I mean, if you need anything to kind of help you understand who he is, this is it. I mean, the beginning, it starts off, you hear the Blue Velvet song playing in the background, and you just see just this very nice, kind of quaint suburban town, lots of picket fences, people waving and smiling like it's a fucking Folgers commercial. A lot of his films, this film in particular, they don't seem to have a particular time period, but they look as though they could be sort of like those doo-woppy, old, nostalgic 1950s towns, kind of Pleasantville-like. And that is something that Lynch has always used to sort of represent that faux sense of purity, something that feels very sour, like these people are just too happy and it's kind of creepy. So it's like he's able to kind of contrast the sort of Doris Day, MGM, Technicolor quality with something that is very eerie and macabre. Anyway, you see this guy who is doing yard work, and he's living out in the suburbs, and he's right in front of his house, and he all of a sudden has this stroke, this massive stroke, and he falls to the ground, and as he's on the ground, the camera zooms down into the grass, and it just goes deeper and deeper, and you see all of these bugs, and they're just buzzing, and it's really very grotesque. It is such a contrast compared to a lot of the imagery that we saw leading up to that. And so that, in a nutshell, is David Lynch. The protagonist in the film is Jeffrey Beaumont, and this is played by Kyle MacLachlan, who has a kind of a blankness about him, which is really great, I think, because he sort of represents us. He is the voyeur. And when he's just walking in a field one day, he comes across a severed ear. And this leads him into this whole investigation journey. He's trying to figure out where the ear came from. And of course, this leads to this very twisted murder mystery that he becomes a part of. He represents the audience, as most protagonists do. But I think in this sense, it's almost literal, because he often in the film, he's hiding and watching things that he probably shouldn't be watching, a lot like the James Stewart character in Rear Window. Jeffrey is exploring his own subconscious, just as we are as we're watching the film. You know, he is starting to discover his lust and the idea of violence and how it is very seductive, very intriguing, and he's discovering a lot about anger, all of these things, and they start to bend and twist together into this sort of melting pot of desire that is deeply embedded in the entertainment. It's like we're watching it and we're enjoying it, but should we be enjoying it? And I think it's the same for him. He is intrigued. There are some incredibly memorable scenes in this film that you will not forget. And I particularly love the scenes that do take place in the Dorothy Valance's apartment, and she sort of plays the victim in the film. I love the way they're shot with the wide angles and all of that, because the camera is kind of pulled back pretty far. It's cold. It's very distant. It's like you can see almost everything in the frame, and yet it is so eerily quiet and you don't know exactly what's going to happen. And it does feel a lot like us in the movie theater, sitting there watching a movie screen. All of these things are happening on the screen and we're just kind of sitting back. It is a sort of detached feeling. And the villain is played by Dennis Hopper, and this is Frank Booth, and this is one of the craziest, most what the fuck villains I have seen in Hollywood movies, for sure. I mean, he is the pure embodiment of all of the things that the average human being neglects within themselves. So, you know, has this very animalistic nature, this regression to childlike tendency, especially when he is aroused sexually. And a lot of that also, with arousal comes a lot of violence. One scene that a lot of people consider to be really weird, and I find it to be one of the most interesting scenes, is where Frank kidnaps Jeffrey and takes him to Ben's house, and he's like a, I guess like a drug dealer slash, it's like a prostitute house, I'm not sure exactly, but Ben is played by Dean Stockwell. I think this scene explores film as an illusion more than maybe any other one in the entire film. This scene is very reminiscent to me of the Club Silencio scene that is in Mulholland Drive. Mulholland Drive was a film that David Lynch made, I want to say about 15 years after this one. Both scenes take place about midway through the film or close to that. Both scenes are of somebody that is lip-syncing a song while the viewer is very moved by it. And the whole scene feels like almost like a purgatory, like it's not quite real, but not quite a dream. And at the point where the scene is transitioning, it's not like they just walk out of the house, they literally disappear. And I think that is like the final touch that drives the concept across. I love that scene just like I love the Club Silencio scene. I probably prefer the Silencio scene much more, but I like that they're both exploring art and film and performance as an illusion that is meant to manipulate your emotions. I mean, even Frank, who is this really terrifying animalistic person, he's listening to the song that Dean Stockwell is well, not really singing, but mouthing, and he's calm for a moment because he is also manipulated, just as we often are when we're watching films. And even at that point, after he is moved and then he moves on, he beats up Jeffrey and leaves him unconscious before they all leave. So it's as if the illusion of entertainment and the romanticism of it moves us to a certain extent, but it also fuels our motivations from that point. And overall, I think the film is extremely focused. It's structured brilliantly, and there's nothing unnecessarily convoluted, which does happen a lot, especially with detective stories, a lot of film noir, things like that. But it is very much designed so that the feelings that are evoked are much more important than the actual plot itself. And I think that's just how Lynch tends to operate. And I love those surrealistic touches that I mentioned earlier. There is a very pivotal scene towards the beginning of the film where Jeffrey, when Jeffrey is introduced to Frank Booth and Dorothy and their relationship for the first time, afterwards, there's this sort of dream sequence where he's reliving a lot of the moments, like he sees Frank laughing in slow motion, and then he sees an image of his father, who's the man who had the stroke earlier, and it's like very distorted and he's talking, but it's really like in slow motion and it's really, really creepy. So things that happened in his real life, like his father being in the hospital, that's obviously an uncomfortable situation for him, but it's frightening on a whole new level now because he's been exposed to a lot of these very dreamlike subconscious ideas that that he was exposed to in Valance's apartment. And that's one of many reasons why I think that Lynch is on the same level as Hitchcock in a lot of ways, because he can take the formulas that we all know and love and suck us into them, but then he can make us consciously aware of all of those conceits and how we're being manipulated. I think that this film, as great as it is, I don't think it's nearly as great as Mulholland Drive. To me, that is David Lynch's masterpiece, because he really pushed the boundaries there in terms of all of these themes and the complexities of them, because he's literally deconstructing the narrative structure, the idea of narrative, through dream logic. And so, I just think it's more creative on every level. But I think that Blue Velvet, he needed to make a film like Blue Velvet to sort of take the steps to get to that point. If you're new to David Lynch, I would actually watch this film first. I think this is the perfect movie to start off with, because it does really feed into his whole philosophy as an artist and as a man. And it's also much more palatable, as I said. So I would start with this one before you go on to movies like Mulholland Drive. And also just because it helps to see the progression of his artistic abilities, I should say. But this is one of the first Lynch films that I ever saw, and it just, I remember watching it and I just couldn't get it out of my mind. I'd never seen anything like it. I'd never seen anything that bizarre and that funny and that uncomfortably intimate. The distorted tone, how disturbing everything was at all, just, it really was unsettling to me, and I didn't quite understand why it affected me so much until later on, of course, when I saw a lot more Lynch and watched Blue Velvet multiple times and realized that this really is a commentary on art and entertainment. And it does explore dreams and all of that, which to me is so interesting. When you can make a film or any piece of art and then kind of really explore the act of actually making it, that to me is when you're really kind of pushing through and really thinking outside the box, in a sense. So yes, David Lynch is incredible. Blue Velvet is incredible. If you haven't seen it, you really should. And that is my review. Thank you all for listening. If you'd like to check out any of my social media information, it's below. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.